Oh, hey there! You might be wondering what all this celebrating is about. Well, it's January 4th, 1896, and Utah has finally become the 45th state to join the United States of America. Did you know it took Utah almost 50 years to become a state? Almost 50 years, that's half a century. So why did it take them so long? Well, Utah encountered a lot of challenges along the way, and while it wasn't an easy journey, finally during the 1890s, Utah's people overcame these challenges and worked together to pave the way to statehood. Utah is an incredible place because it's home to people of all different backgrounds. Native Americans, Latinos, and immigrants like me from America, Europe, Asia, and the Pacific. And together we built Utah into the state it is today. So where does the Utah story start? It starts more than 12,000 years ago when the first Native Americans made Utah their home. Over thousands of years, these early hunters gradually changed their lifestyles. About 1,000 years ago, the Fremont and ancestral Puebloan peoples in this region were skilled farmers, craftsmen, and traders. Utah's native cultures continued to evolve into different groups, the Goshute, Paiute, Shoshone, Ute, and Navajo people, each with their own language and way of life. When Europeans began to enter Utah, Native Americans engaged with the newcomers through diplomacy and trade. In 1776, the same year the 13 colonies declared independence, Spanish explorers began to travel through Utah. But what were Spanish explorers doing here? At this time, Utah was part of the vast Spanish Empire, which connects with Utah's important Latino heritage. Soon, Spanish traders from Santa Fe developed trading relationships with Navajo and Ute people along the old Spanish Trail in southeastern Utah. In the north, Shoshone and Ute people traded furs with Americans and French trappers, people you might know as mountain men. This is not the only part of our story, though, and these aren't the only people that helped build Utah. During the 1800s, things really changed for Utah, as immigrants from all over the world came to this place. In 1847, a new group of immigrants began to settle in the Salt Lake Valley. If you know about Utah, you might have heard of this group. These immigrants were the members of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, sometimes called by their nickname, Mormons. They were looking for a place to live where they could escape persecution or the people who were bullying them. Brigham Young led this group to settle outside the United States. Believe it or not, at the time, Utah was part of Mexico. But at the end of the Mexican-American War, Mexico lost its huge northern territories to the United States. Overnight, Utah belonged to America. Before 1870, most immigrants came by wagon or stagecoach, but after 1869, the Transcontinental Railroad carried thousands of new immigrants, businesses, and industries to Utah. As decades passed, immigrants from all over the world transformed Utah. Coming from Europe, Asia, and North America, they worked, opened businesses, and built communities here. Latinos, Chinese, and Japanese immigrants worked in railroad and mining towns. Irish immigrants worked in Utah's mining country. Italians settled Salt Lake City's west side in what became known as Little Italy. And thousands of Mormon converts came from Britain, Scandinavia, and Northern Europe. All this immigration created huge challenges for Utah's Native American communities. When immigrants built new settlements, they claimed vital natural resources such as water and farmland. This threatened native food systems, leading to a time of great change, suffering, and adaptation. But Utah's native people persisted and learned new ways to survive. This is where our story starts to get a little bit more complicated. Remember how I said it took almost 50 years for Utah to become a state? Well, 48 to be exact, and 6 failed attempts. Let's take a closer look because it really did require the diverse people of Utah to work together and overcome their differences to achieve this larger goal of statehood. Early Mormon leaders applied to create a state this big in 1848, but their first attempt totally failed. Because of national politics at the time surrounding slavery in the West, Congress would not admit the state of Deseret. Historian Paul Reeve explains what this meant for Utah.
So Utah is rejected in its application for statehood, but admitted as a territory. As a territory, you don't get to vote for President of the United States. You don't get to vote for who is your governor or who are your judges. Those are all appointed by the President of the United States and confirmed by the U.S. Senate.
5 more statehood attempts failed as well. The key issues preventing statehood centered on Mormon cultural practices that seemed un-American to many non-Mormons.
The statehood debates made it clear that those in Utah, according to those in Congress, were not American. They weren't true Americans because they were doing things that were deemed un-American. They were engaged in polygamy, and there was an overlap between party politics and religious faith. And as long as Congress looked in on Utah and saw those two things in operation, they continually rejected Utah's applications for statehood.
Polygamy, in which one man married more than one wife, was supported by the LDS Church at this time. But national leaders believed polygamy was wrong, so Congress passed several laws designed to stop polygamy in Utah. When these laws limited Mormons' religious practices, Church President Wilford Woodruff issued a manifesto that reversed the Church's policy on polygamy. Historian Jean Bickmore White explains,
"The 1890 Manifesto of the Mormon Church helped to foster a new and improved national image for the territory."
LDS church leaders recognized the importance of collaborating with railroads and other national businesses to help Utah's economy thrive and achieve statehood status. But religion still divided the state. The Utah Territory did not have the kind of political parties, schools, or other community institutions that would allow people of all faiths to work together. Utah needed to be more unified. Both Mormon and non-Mormon leaders worked to overcome these cultural and political differences. One of them was Isaac Trumbo, who helped Utah become eligible for statehood by encouraging Utahns to join either the Democrat or Republican parties. Women's advocacy and leadership played a crucial role in shaping Utah for statehood as well. Women from all kinds of rural and urban towns ran farms and businesses, helped raise children, and worked to sustain local communities. And in Utah, women were very involved in the political process of statehood.
Emmeline B. Wells was one of Utah's leading suffragists who really worked to build bridges across religious divides here in Utah and nationally, and she worked to reach out to suffragists who weren't always in favor of Utah women's right to vote.
Utah women had gained the right to vote in 1870, but it was taken away during the fight to end polygamy. After that, Utah women worked tirelessly to have women's voting rights included in the new state. In 1895, the Republican African American Women's Club of Salt Lake City, yes, black women were politically organized, worked for black equality and women's voting rights in Utah. With all these efforts from so many of Utah's communities, President Grover Cleveland signed the declaration on January 4, 1896, making Utah the 45th state of the United States of America. Celebrations erupted all over the state. So what did statehood mean for all of Utah's diverse people? Did everyone benefit from statehood? The answer is yes and no. Yes, statehood was a victory for most Utahns because it gave all American citizens the right to vote, including women and African Americans. This made Utah more inclusive than most other states in America at this time. And also no, people who had immigrated to Utah from Asian countries were not allowed to become American citizens at this time, so they did not receive voting rights or citizenship when Utah became a state. Native Americans were not included either.
They were not talking about whether Native Americans were Americans. That's funny sounding. A Native American is not an American. And in 1896, they were not an American. They were not citizens, remember? But mostly, they didn't talk about Utah's indigenous people. They were pretty much invisible.
In fact, the state of Utah denied Native American people voting rights until 1957, 61 years after statehood. But now, Utah is home to 8 sovereign Native nations, and Native people live, work, and contribute to Utah communities all across the state. Utah's struggle for statehood laid the groundwork for these groups to work toward achieving political rights as Americans and Utahns. So how does this impact you? What do we learn from the story of statehood?
Well, what happened to Utah's indigenous people, the way they were legislated against and forgotten and had to fight and claw and go to court in order to gain the same rights and privileges as other Utahns, this should help us all appreciate how important our own rights as citizens are in the state of Utah.
So that we can hopefully stand in places of empathy for those who in the 21st century are being defined outside of the bounds of what it means to be an American. Are we drawing lines religiously for other immigrant groups, such as Muslims coming to the United States? Are we drawing lines racially for those who are marginalized in the United States? Or are we willing to stretch our definition of who we the people are to include all people?
We learned from Utah's history that statehood was the work of many individuals, not just a small group of politicians, business, or church leaders. People from all over the world came together here and built Utah through their work, families, and communities. In the process, they learned that they had to look beyond their differences to build a more fair, just, and inclusive state. This did not end in 1896. It continues to this day. You can honor those who first built Utah by sharing your voice and by listening to those who may not be heard.